Well, good morning, Reclaim Church San Antonio. It's exciting to see you guys all here in the house of the Lord for our Sunday morning service. Can we stand to our feet if you're able? We're going to get ready to worship the Lord right now. And we know that the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So this morning, the Spirit of the Lord lives inside you. You have a freedom. Today, I ask you guys just to worship in that freedom. Just don't worry about what you came in with. Leave it there. And this is a time to worship the Lord. Our altar is up here at the front. If you want to worship at the front, let's go ahead and get ready to worship and open up in prayer. Lord, we come before you this morning, God, thanking you, Lord God, for who you are, Lord God. And right now, God, I ask that we would all feel your presence in this place, Lord God, that you'd receive these praises, God, from hearts that are surrendered and free in you, Jesus. We love you and we praise you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Spirit, where you're in my heart now. Drink from the Shine on me, lift up your soul, 'cause you've got a lion Don't you get shy of me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come my soul. Don't you get shy of me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Come on, my soul.
Don't you get shy of me, lift up your soul. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
So I
throw up my head, praise you again and again. It's all that I have is the
church. Give him some praise this morning. The Lord is worthy this morning. God, you are so good. You are so good, and we thank you for your Holy Spirit in this place. We know there's power in the name Jesus today. Oh, there's power in the blood of Jesus today. Oh, Lord, there's nothing that you can't do. Church, do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that this morning? Let's press in right now. We've worshiped him. Let's let him know that we're here for him today. So, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for opening our eyes this morning. We thank you for the breath in our lungs today, God. Oh, Lord, use us all for your purpose and glory. Father, your plan is greater for us, Lord. As we come in today, pour out your spirit. Oh, Lord, come rest on every person in here. No matter what we believe today, Lord, you are King and you are Lord of our lives. And we ask today you bring revelation to this church. You bring understanding to this church. You bring patience and endurance to this church. Oh, Lord, that we would give you praise, glory, and honor, Lord, because you are worthy. You alone are worthy of all things. We ask, Lord, that you move today. You move freely and you do what only you can do. Have your way in your church in Jesus' name. Come on, one more time. Let's give him some praise. Amen and amen. Welcome, welcome, church, to Reclaim San Antonio. It's good to see you today. Why don't you greet your neighbors? Say hello. It's good to see them. Amen. Praise God.
Said it.
Welcome to Reclaim Church San Antonio. It's always good to see everyone's smiling faces on a Sunday morning. Praise God. Thank you for joining us. We want to welcome you. Those who are here in person, thank you for being here. And those of you joining us on Facebook or YouTube, thank you for sharing, for liking, for subscribing. We appreciate the support. I'm going to go into some announcements, but before I do that, I want to, it really is hard to see up here, but I'm not sure if there's anyone here for your first time. If it is your first time, we want to, not to embarrass you, if you could just raise your hand so we kind of wave at you, just say hi. We have a welcome gift for you. If not, you guys are all Reclaim Church, and thank you for being here on Sunday. So let me go through some announcements. Thank you. before we take up an offering, tomorrow night for the men of Reclaim Church, we have a men's discipleship that will be taking place in Reclaim Hutto. So it's okay to get excited for that, men, whoever's. if you are interested in going, you could see my husband. I know they carpool up there. I think they're meeting at 4 p.m. at Pastor's house, at my house. So if you're interested in going, concerned about the drive and whatnot, meet up with my husband. To see about connecting and carpooling up there. It's nice to go with a group of, men to represent our church and just to support the fellowship that we're a part of. Amen. So then that's tomorrow night. And Wednesday, every Wednesday, we have our worship and prayer service. This Wednesday, for the rest of the Wednesdays of January, we are fasting and praying. Amen. So last Wednesday was our first. I encourage you guys, if you've never fasted before, It helps your spirit. It helps your walk. It helps you in your faith grow deeper with the Lord. Try it. If you can't fast the whole day, I encourage you, fast a meal and spend that time in prayer. Spend that time, drawing close to the Lord. And even if you can't fast for medical reasons or whatever other reason you might have, still join us for prayer. We meet every Wednesday anyway for prayer, for worship, and we come together in agreement to pray for personal needs and as well as the needs of the church. So I encourage you guys, for the rest of January, that will be our prayer and fasting, but we'll be here Wednesday at 7 p.m. This Friday, the 20th, we have our youth night. Amen. They meet next door. So if you know any young people, teenagers, they meet every other Friday. So they'll be next door on the 20th at 7 p.m. If you have any questions about that, you can see Marcus or Johnny. They can get you information for that. And then this Saturday morning, we have our Saturday morning prayer at 8:30. We meet here in the sanctuary. Again, we pray for personal needs. We pray for corporately together. So I encourage you guys to be a part of that. And then, again, the men have a men's breakfast on Saturday. It's time to get excited. I think, I'm pretty sure, I might be mistaken, but I believe, too, that these men's discipleships, they feed you, too, I think. So, hey, it's a good week to participate in these men's events, guys. So Saturday we'll also have a men's breakfast right after prayer, but at 10:30 a.m. So come, for morning prayer, feed your spirit, men, and then afterwards stay for the men's breakfast and feed your bellies. So with that, we're going to go ahead and get ready to receive an offering. If I can have the ushers come up. If you need an envelope, you can raise your hand and we'll get one to you. We have baskets placed up here for check or cash, whatever you have for that. And then we also have multiple ways to give that will be on the screen. Those are there for you guys as well. And then with that, I'm going to have my brother Mackenzie receive the offering. And I'm sorry, also there's no preteen class today. So for our elementary age kids, we do have that class following the offering.
Amen. Good morning. I had a powerful time in the Lord. Wow. I was almost wrecked up here. Like I have to stand up, Lord, and keep worshiping. Amen. So as I was praying about the offering, the Lord kept reminding me of something Pastor Rudy said. And he said that we are a product of our past. We're not a prisoner of it. And that really struck deep within me And it was a very humbling moment for myself. It was. The statement he made is so full of the Lord's wisdom, so full of it. And if you really receive it, it has many meanings. And to me, it was also a command. And the command states this: don't stay in the past, learn from it. Learn from your past. So I looked back at the first time I gave the offering, and guys, it was terrible. It was completely terrible. And it was because I was trying to get to the scripture, and I deleted it in my nervousness. I deleted it. I was like, oh. So I looked up, and I put my hands in my pocket. I said, Lord, help me. And I stood up, and I said, hey, guys, let's talk about trust. And so I'm walking back and forth nervous, and, you know, it was just bad. So because I am a product of my past and not a prisoner of it, let's talk about trust. Amen. In Connect Group on Friday, I'd explained who I was before salvation and placing my trust fully in Jesus, before I really surrendered to the Lord. I was a selfish man who could not trust anyone, only in myself, and I struggled with that. Though through the Lord's mercy and healing, I began to finally trust people because I knew the Lord would guide me and teach me where to place my trust. And the first person I have placed my trust fully besides the Lord is my spiritual father, Pastor Rudy. And I can stand here in front of you to say that with full confidence. Him and I have been on a journey together for about 3 years. And if you place your trust in your pastor, Pastor Rudy, your future will be bright. He hears from the Lord very sensitively, and I can say that after 3 years of being molded by the Lord. I'm getting emotional, so hold on a second. The Lord placed my pastor in my life to lead me and guide me so I would fully trust him. It's his perfect will. And you are here as well now, placed with this pastor to lead and guide you. And he didn't know I was going to say this today. And you're probably asking yourself right now, what has this to do with the offering? And the answer is this: everything. Everything. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, it says, then if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. The Lord has many promises in his word that declares these things. Promises. They're promises. And if we do these things he commands us to do, he will heal us and restore our land. My finances struggled for years and years and years without the Lord. And the moment that I decided to believe in the Lord's promises and finally give what I was commanded to give in my tithes and offerings, the Lord kept his promise of the abundance he says he will give. Burdens were removed from me pretty immediately. And now the Lord blessed me with a career path with the potential to one day allow me to help equip other children in God's kingdom as well. I prayed for this, and I walked in obedience, and I walk in obedience, and I fully surrender to all his commands, placing my full trust in him. So as we give our offerings today, my prayer is that you place your full trust in the Lord. He is always faithful. He never fails you. Remember, when we obey his commands, commands for a future and a hope, he will fulfill his promises. Trust in the promises of the Lord and know he will open the floodgates of heaven for you. And if you need an envelope, go ahead and raise your hand and we'll get those to you. So let us pray. So dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for allowing us to choose to trust you, God, fully and surrendering all of our vessel to you, God. In every part of our lives, we give this to you, God. We trust you with all things. And we trust in your promises of abundance that you will pour out heaven upon us right now, Lord. We know and believe these things. We love you and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. You want it all.
give you, Lord, some praise this morning as I get started today. Amen. I get encouraged when I hear people clap along with me and they praise God too. We're all here for the same reason. I'm praying for that. And welcome again to Reclaim Church San Antonio. It's always a blessing when people come and just want to spend time in the Lord. And just want to thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness to this ministry. God has assembled his people all for his purpose and glory, and he's doing a mighty work. And amen. And thank you to my spiritual son in the faith. I probably won't live up to that expectation. That's a tough one. Trust God. Put all your faith and trust in God. Amen. He will never let you down. And amen. And I still fall short every day. Praise God. And so as we start this new month of January, I know, jumping ahead to February already. It kind of mixed up my plans when we had a guest speaker last week. And I'm glad that we had Pastor Victor and Jackie Damridge. Weren't they a blessing to the church last week? And I had an idea of the direction I was going in, but that all got changed when God just made an opportunity to have them. Pastor Victor is my dear friend, and I've known him for many years, and he's spoken into my life so much. And it's good to have friends in the faith that can always encourage you. Anytime he comes around, he always lifts me up, encourages me, no matter what I'm going through. And that's what a brother and sister in the Lord can do for you. Make those connections, build relationships with your brothers and sisters, and the times when you're down and out and you're not feeling it, God will use them to encourage you and to lift you up. And so I appreciate them for coming by. They were there for a birthday weekend for his wife. And he wanted to come to church, and he brought some of his family members. So praise God for that. Amen. And so today, church, I'm going to get into a little deep discussion. Not too long, hopefully. We'll see what the Lord does. But I want to talk about the revelation of God. Now, not just the book of Revelation, but the revelation of who he is. And that can be a profound subject because it's so broad. There's so much revelation that comes from God. And a lot of times, if you find yourself, have you ever asked, you know, you're just waiting to understand why God has called you or what God is going to do in your life, or why don't you understand the Bible, his word? And there's a lot of things that we ask questions about. Some people even say, well, I just don't feel it. I don't feel it. I don't feel God. I don't feel his word. I don't know. I'm just going through this life until God audibly speaks to me. Don't wait for that, okay? The audible speaking. I'll be honest with you, in the years that I've been a servant of the Lord, he's never spoken to me audibly. And I mean, it would probably freak me out if I heard his voice coming from the clouds or the sky or a burning bush. I'd be like, whoa, who's behind there? Not that my faith, is, he can do it, but it would shock me. But how many know that God can reveal to you the things of God in so many different ways? It's not just through his word. It's not through his church, but so many things. I mean, the Lord can speak through a donkey. He can speak through animals. He can speak through a burning bush. He can speak through so many ways that'll blow our minds. And so I'm going to talk about revelation. Let me share the definition, what the dictionary says about revelation, and we'll get into this. So revelation, the first definition is a surprising or previously unknown fact, especially one that is made known in a dramatic way. Or the divine reason, or the description, definition. The divine or supernatural disclosure to humans of something relating to human existence of the world. And so, Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, that's going to be the scripture of today. And if you read with me right here, it says this, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show to his servants the things that must take place, may soon take place. I'm going to stop right there for now. Amen. But soon may take place. What does that mean? The things that must soon take place. Let me pray. So, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord, for your presence in this place. I thank you, Lord, for all the things that you're doing. I thank you, Lord, for the things you're going to do. Lord, I thank you for your Holy Spirit and everyone here, Lord. And I just pray you just move, Lord, bring revelation and understanding. Do what only you can do. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. It's so critical to know this as a believer, because a lot of people come to the Lord and they may not feel so spiritual. And so when you come to the Lord and you're just trying to figure things out on your understanding, it won't make sense. And so if you try to read the Bible sometimes, you're just opening it up and you're reading it. It gets confusing at times. And if not you, it was for me when I first started off. The Bible says, some people will say, I don't know about this spiritual thing. You know, I'll read his word and stuff. But the Bible says that how will you understand spiritual things if you're not spiritual? And so some people just believe that, you know, we're flesh and bone, and that's all to us. The heart is beating for some reason. We don't know why, but God allows that. And so if we're not careful, we will brush off the things that are spiritual because it doesn't make sense, the natural. And so the doctrine of revelation, let me show you what that is. The doctrine of revelation, it's what God reveals. What God reveals to you. When God reveals his truth that otherwise you wouldn't understand, that's called revelation. The Bible, when he speaks to us through his word, he's speaking truths spiritually. And if you're not reading it or trying to understand it, those things that you have in mind, those questions you have, won't be answered. And so that's why I want to talk about this today, because human reasoning and intuition and all those things, you could never understand the things of God by your own understanding. I'm telling you, yeah, God was, when people come to salvation, God spoke to them. God drew them. They don't understand, but I feel good, and I want more of what feels good. And then all of a sudden, they get saved, and all of a sudden, the next day, they're like, I still have my problems. Why didn't they disappear? God can do all things, right? So if we're not careful, we get saved, and we'll receive salvation, but we don't want the transformation because that hurts. So I want you to bear with me as I talk about revelation today. And one thing that Paul was praying for the church at Ephesus in the book of Ephesians, and it's not going to be up there. I'm going to read this to you. This was his prayer to a people that didn't understand. It's a church. He's like, they're doing whatever they want. He wants them to be encouraged. He wants to be uplifted to them. So this is what he writes in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18. It's not going to be up. I'm going to read it to you. It says this in verse 18. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you'll be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. There's so much power. When you receive the Lord, if you're a believer in this place, there's so much power, but if you don't understand it, why will you access it? People say, how can God's love be this big? Because I know, humanly speaking, love runs out. You know how I know? When somebody gets you upset, when somebody lets you down, when somebody breaks your heart, do you still love them? Is it a selfish love, or is it a love that's limited? God's love is so great and so vast, we can't fully understand it unless you tap into it spiritually. So the Bible says don't get upset if somebody doesn't believe what you're saying about the Lord. The spiritual veil hasn't been lifted yet. So don't beat yourself up if you're trying to get your family member to believe who God is. Believe it how I believe it. Doesn't it make sense to you? It makes sense to me. Why doesn't it make sense to you? There's a time when God will remove the spiritual veil. So just keep praying. Keep praying and pressing to God. You can't force anybody to believe who God is. You can't change anybody. You can't bring conviction to anybody. Holy Spirit does that. We will bring condemnation. Don't make anybody feel bad because they don't understand the way you do, and beat them up because, you know, in their mind, right, this makes sense to them. The word of God is different. I can't believe those stories. And I remember new in the faith, my family would tell me, oh, it's just fairy tales. And that I changed my life, that I started changing. I got tired. I wanted to improve. I did. But I tried to improve myself until I surrendered to God. Those are the things that changed me. I remember in the Old Testament, if you read the Old Testament, God used prophets. So you hear all these different prophets in the Old Testament. They're used to speak God to them, to speak godly stuff to them. And people that received it, they were being used to understand that the prophets were being used to reveal the spiritual truths. Now, with Jesus, he changed that. When Jesus came, God himself came into human form to show us an example of human living Christ-like. We know Christ was perfect, and we're not. We shouldn't beat ourselves up because we don't do everything perfectly, as you shouldn't beat up your family member that doesn't believe as you believe. Revelation in Scripture Revelation in Scripture is everything you need to understand God's plan. But if we don't read or if we don't pray, we don't spend time in His presence, we won't understand those things. So if you're a believer in this place and you want those things, God, I just want to I want to have faith like this person. Be careful when you ask that. I've known so many people where I'm like, I want that type of faith. They go, let me tell you what I've been through. And so when you ask for patience, God will make you wait. How are you going to learn patience if you don't know how to wait? God will give you those experiences. But I'm going to share some scripture here. We're going to kind of, I'm not going to go too fast, but I'm not going to stay too long in it either. But how God reveals things through His word. When Jesus was speaking to Simon Peter in Matthew chapter 16, I'm going to read verses 17. They're going to be up here. So just bear with me as I read these scriptures. So Matthew 16. Then He asked them, "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "You are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being." I can tell you over and over, Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and you need to receive Him. But until God reveals that to you, you won't do it. God draws people to Him. The Lord speaks through His revelation through His word, like in John chapter 14, verse 7. Verse 6, I'm sorry. Jesus said to him, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So there are all these religions and doctrines of the world, and they say, "Oh, I'm searching for a supreme being, a higher being, God. It's all the same." No, it's not. Jesus, that's the way, the truth, and the life that you need to seek. If you want understanding, you go through Jesus to the Father. When John starts writing the book of Revelation, because God gave him a vision, he's right. This is the same scripture I started with. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him, showed to his servants the things that must soon take place. There are things that are coming that we don't understand. And unless we ask to God to reveal that to us, we won't understand. We'll just wait. We'll just wait. Like, I don't know what's coming, but I'm going to wait. Do you ever do that? Do you wait for things you don't know about? I know I wouldn't. But I want to understand those things. So I seek God in those things. Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Hear me. For everyone, not some people, but everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. You go, Pastor, you don't know those people. They're evil. But if they call in the name of the Lord, they'll be saved. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So faith comes from hearing, that is hearing the good news, the gospel, the word of God about Christ. You see, that's where our faith grows. When people stay away from God's house, when they stay away from God's word, all those different things, how does their faith increase? But faith comes from hearing the word of God. Amen. John 6, 44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. You understand how important that is? You can't force anybody to accept who Jesus is. You can't force anybody to start believing in who He is. You can't force anybody to receive salvation. Unless God draws him, that's when he'll know who he is. And this last scripture right here, Proverbs 29, 18. I'm going to read out the King James first. Proverbs 29, 18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. In the New King's Translation, it says, where there is no revelation, the people can't cast off restraint. So you have to understand this. Vision, revelation, all those things that we need to know. How do you know or understand unless you ask? See, God will reveal those things when He's calling you, but unless you ask to receive it, you won't understand it. And I remember in my life, there was a time when, and some of you know my life, that there's a lot of problems in my life, even in my Christian walk. Not that I was stumbling in my Christian walk, but my faith was struggling because I thought I had it all together before I came to the Lord. Yeah, I made mistakes like everybody makes. But I always figured, you know what? As long as I have a job and I have money in the bank, I'll be okay. And as I got closer to the Lord, that was something I wouldn't let go. And I told my wife a long time ago, if we ever thought about starting a church, and we had a Bible study, I go, you know what? I could never leave California because I won't get a job like I have now somewhere else. And she's like, okay, well, you know, if that's, you know, what you say. And a couple years later, I don't know what happened. Well, God knows. But I started, I got laid off for the first time. And then I couldn't find a job, a steady job for about, I don't know, 2-3 years. One after another, I was getting laid off or it didn't work out. And all of a sudden, we found ourselves depleting our whole life savings. It wasn't a lot. We were only married a few years. But everything we had saved that we brought into the marriage was almost depleted. So much so, I cast in my 401k because I was desperate. And I didn't know how we were gonna make ends meet. Our son Zeke had come, and we wanted to make sure he was taken care of. My wife had a good job. She worked for Honda, and she resigned her job to stay home. So now we went from 2 incomes to 1. I'm like, God, you're going to do it. Instead, I got laid off. Okay. God of everything, you're going to have your way. You're going to do something. But more and more, it didn't seem like I was coming out of that trial. So much so, we lost everything. And I mean everything. Our cars, we turned them in, everything. And we were about to be homeless. My father-in-law asked, and he said we can move in up in Modesto. He asked us to come live there, live in a room. He has an extra room for me and my family, and just start fresh. And that sounded great to me. God, you opened the door. Praise God. Amen. I'm not going to be homeless. Amen. How sweet that was. We got a place to go. Love my family up north. My wife was happy. Okay, new life, new transition. God is in it. I'll tell you this. Even though we said it, I did not see God in it. I didn't see it. I was like, God, this is our church here in California, in L.A. How could you be uprooting us and taking us somewhere without any money? And I'm gonna reference this today, but I said, I may not see you, God, but I know you're with me somehow. And I know that nothing is impossible for you. I know you can do it. You can do all these things. Then God began to reveal things to me, open up doors. I didn't stop teaching my Bible study during that time. That was crazy to me because everything was falling apart in my life, but I still, on Friday night, would teach Bible study. And I know that sustained me. Whatever little that I had, I knew that God gave it to me, so I always was faithful in my tithes and offerings. See, God doesn't, it doesn't matter how much you give as long as you're obedient to his word. When he says 10% of a million is a lot different from 10% of a dollar, right? It's probably easier to give 10% of a dollar in some people's minds, right? Amen. Nobody said amen. Wow. Okay, give it all. Amen. I'm going this direction to say this to you as a believer. I'm going to speak to the believer of the house today. Revelation. Do you want understanding? It has to be God that reveals it to you. The one that can do that is here in this place, the Holy Spirit. He's the one that reveals spiritual truths and understanding. He can show you your life, but you have to ask and believe in him. The next scripture right here was one that I didn't like for a long time. And I'm going to share that today. It's Psalms chapter 34. Can you put it up there for me, please? Read this with me. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Stop right there. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. I was like, what? Many are the afflictions of the righteous. God, that doesn't sound right. If I'm trying to become righteous and holy, why do I want many afflictions? That's when God revealed himself to me. He said, not audibly, okay, I would have freaked out. But in his word it says, but the Lord will deliver him out of them all. Not some of them. Every problem you're going through, everything that hurts you, everything that disappoints you, everything you suffer from, everything that you lack, God will deliver you from them. He'll take you to a place of spiritual understanding. When I started going through things, or I continue to go through things, those afflictions, I was joyful that God was with me. I didn't understand it, but I said, Lord, your word says you will deliver me out of every single one of them, all of them. And the more that I pressed in and said, Lord, I need you now. I need to hold on to you because I don't like this one. But I'll reveal some other things to you. Whether you're a believer or not, you're going to go through things. Whether you believe it or not, the body that you live in right now is dying. Some sooner than others. You know, we want to prolong that as much as possible. God says, come home. If you don't know the Lord, I mean, you want to be in good graces with the Lord when he calls you. But here's the thing. The Lord didn't promise a perfect life after you got saved. Some people have the perception, I start coming to church, everything's going to be perfect. Let me show you the scripture again. Many are the problems. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord your God, will deliver them out of each every one. It's like going to the gym, right? Who's going to the gym in their New Year resolution? Amen. You still going? Praise the Lord. 15th, halfway through the month, all right? What happens when you've been out of the gym for a while and you go back and start lifting weights or whatever you're doing? You get sore. You get hurt. And after a while, your body starts to repair, right? That's the goal. It starts to heal and you start losing weight, looking better, and it hurts less. It's the same thing with our faith. You need to exercise your faith. You need to put your faith in action when you go through problems. As a believer in this place, God already told you, you're going to go through things. But I'm going to see you through it. Your faith has to be in me, though. I'm going to see you through, but your faith has to be in me. And when your faith is in him, and you've gone through this struggle already, say it's a financial struggle. I know a lot of people, and Mackenzie asked, he actually shared a little bit today. So many people who were down and out financially. My brother Mackenzie was broke. Amen. He's like, what am I going to do, Pastor? We're going to pray. And you're going to be faithful. And God's going to see you through it. And God did. So many, now in his spiritual walk, 3 years it's been now, has his finances been perfect? I'm putting him on the spot here. But they haven't. But when I would talk to him, he said, Pastor, God's going to do something because I'm struggling right now. Amen. That should be our attitude, though. I'm going through something right now. God is moving. When you go through problems, especially a lot of them, you're like one after another. Oh, man, when it rains, it pours. When that starts happening, just know this. That's a recipe for a miracle that only God can do. You have to believe that this morning. When things are going wrong in your life, it's one after another. The God of the universe tells you, you're going to go through things, but I'm going to see you through all of them. I'm going to see you through all of them. You are called as a believer, as the temple of the Holy Spirit. Man can't destroy that temple. It's God's house. God dwells in you, but you have to activate it. You have to say, God, everything I'm showing you right now comes through revelation. Because you might be thinking, man, I've been through stuff over and over, Pastor, you don't even know. I may not see you, God, but you say you're with me. Where are you, God? He says, I'm with you. God is so good. He will deliver them out. There are so many testimonies. The Bible shows you examples of what God can do. If you don't know the stories, I'm going to just quickly. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, did you know all their wives couldn't have kids? They were all barren. But they all delivered babies. Didn't matter their age. Amen. Amen. Joseph, I'm sure he was a little punk kid. Hey, my brothers, you know, bow down to me. All you guys. Imagine if I'm new to church. Hey, all of you going to bow down to me. God already showed me. Just start being submissive right now. Spiritually speaking, right? I imagine Joseph was that kid. What did his brothers do? Threw him in a pit. Like some of us would, right? Get over here. Get in the pit. Then they felt bad. Reuben felt bad. I was like, get him out of there. Just sell him into slavery. That's better. Sell him to slavery. That's better. And then after he's there, and he starts to rise up because God has his hand on him because he already knew there's going to be things he's going to go through. You see, many are the afflictions of the righteous. God revealed to him who he was going to be. Now, God didn't control how he acted like a little punk, probably. I don't know. I'm just saying that. If I was to say that, I'm just thinking of a teenager trying to tell me, bow down, Pastor. Anyways, some of your youth are going to be great men and women of God. At home, you see how they act at home? Tell them, you're going to be a great man of God. You're going to be a great woman of God. And I'm going to allow you. Because God chose you. because God chose you. God revealed these things to you. Live by that. Live in confidence of who God is. So listen, Joseph gets thrown in the pit. And they're like, let's not let him die that way. Let's put him into slavery so he's hard labor for the rest of his life. But God has his hand on him because God will see you through every one of them. So God delivered him from the pit. He delivered him from slavery from where he was and put him in the palace. And he became Potiphar's assistant, right? He came, you know, his supervisor in there. Favor of the Lord. And then Potiphar's wife messed things up for him, right? She tried to seduce him. And, you know, they tell Potiphar, he liked Joseph. He said, Joseph, I got to make an example. I'm not going to kill you. I'm going to put you in prison now. Because he went into prison, he got favor with the warden. Started having special favors, and he was probably what do you call them? I don't know what they're called. I don't want to say that. Anyways, I have a lot of family in prison, but praying for them. Amen. Here's the thing. One after another, the trials that he went through, they were needed for him to become second in command of Egypt, to be used by God. You may not understand the afflictions in your life. There are things that you don't like. There's things that, God, where are you? You might be the person telling your loved one, look, you've been serving God and you're still suffering. I feel good. It happens. It happens all the time. I remember as I would go through things, and when my son Zeke was born, when he was born dead and God revived him, I remember my family was like talking to my other friends. Is Rudy still in church? Man, after all that stuff? Amen. I was still in church. Because God is still good. Everything that you go through, everything you go through right now, you hold on because God will see you through it. He will see you through it with Gideon and the mighty men of valor. I mean, come on. God was like, come on, mighty men of valor. He's like, I'm the least of my people. How could you use me? God revealed to him, you're going to be a mighty warrior. God's calling him, not what he was right there, but who he was going to be. You have to speak that over your children and your family. Speak to them and let them know God has a plan for your life. Plant those seeds and watch God reveal it and grow it in them. You have to believe that. I'm telling you, a lot of times we will get discouraged. We're trying to raise our children in godly homes. I'm coming to church right now. Me. Get dressed. Comb your hair. Brush your teeth. Is that just in my house? Get up. Comb your hair. Anyways. We bring them to church, right? Who are you? How are you? Oh, it's so peaceful. Get in the car right now. I'm going to get you. Act right. Don't embarrass me there. Get home. Watch. I'm taking all your stuff away from you. That's just us, huh? That's what happens. So what are our kids going to do as they get older? Hopefully go to church. Hey, brother, sister. Right? You see where I'm going with that? Listen. God created you. God created your children for his purpose. This is why he gives revelation. If you don't understand what God's plan is for your life, you need to seek him spiritually. You can ask him in the physical, but you need to seek him spiritually. God has given us many, he's given us many gifts that we have to activate, but we don't, because sometimes we believe it's the foolish things of God. But God will use the foolish things to confound the wise. Even in speaking in tongues, not everybody believes that. I believe that comes from the Holy Spirit, and you have it inside you. But sometimes you say, I don't have that gift. I believe you have it, but have you activated it yet? That comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. It comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, when you allow God, when you surrender to God, there are people that are saved, but they're not surrendered. There's a difference. I'll receive salvation, amen, but I don't want transformation. Because that requires surrenderance. That requires obedience. Hear me. That obedience is not to your pastor. That's your obedience to God. But because you're obedient to him, it looks that way in church. When you serve God, when you want to do things for God, God called you to do that. If I ask you to do something, it's not because I'm demanding, I'm lording over you, right? It's not me, but I see God's doing something in your life. I'm talking to the new person and the person that's been here with us for a while. God has a plan for you. It hasn't changed. We change. Our circumstance changes, not God. Isaiah 43:7 says, everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, I have formed him. Yes, I have made him. God made you exactly how he wants you. Revelation 4:11, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. That's why we worship God. You want to get spiritual? Worship God. When you want to get spiritual, you have to worship God. I'm going to tell you three. There's many reasons to worship God. Many reasons. There's three that I want to talk about right now, just briefly. The first thing you do, you know what happens when you decide to worship? When you worship in the front? See, in the back, if you raise your hands, but you see everything around you, right? When you worship God, no matter what you're going through, however you do it, you lift your hands here, whatever, it doesn't matter. When you worship God, it takes your focus off your problems and onto God. Even if you're trying to do it, Lord, I just want to worship. Talk to him. I have a problem with you, Lord, but I'm going to worship you. Talk to him. It takes the focus off you and puts it on him. The second thing, when you worship God in the church or at home, wherever you are, the enemy flees. The enemy can't stand with you. He can't annoy you when you're worshiping God. When you're worshiping God and you're just feeling it, you're praising him, the enemy can't stay. He has to run. I remember I went praying for a couple that the woman was sick. And I remember being in a house, and I went with some brothers, and the brother God had given many gifts. And I remember when I was praying for her, and she was demonically oppressed, and she didn't want us there, but her family members did. And I said, well, let's see what happens. Let's see what God does. So I remember we started praying for her, and all of a sudden she became light. Like all of a sudden she was like normal. And the brother looked up and he said, oh my gosh. He felt the weight. He saw things spiraling above the house. We were worshiping, praying, anointing her. And I was like, she was set free. She was talking normal. I mean, her family was, oh my gosh. They were talking. The minute we left the house, they all came back. She became the same person she was. She allowed the demons to oppress her. I don't think she was possessed. I think she was oppressed. Oppressed with depression, anger, and anxiety, and all those things that attach to each other. When you worship God, the enemy flees. Worship in your home. Worship in your home. The third thing is you invite the presence of God right where you're at. And allows God to move. Many things are won. Many blessings come through your worship. I found that so many times that when I've been worshiping God, I didn't have a clue how to get through these things. But when I worshiped God, it made a way. Some of you were here that when they were about to shut us down. They actually shut us down for our second anniversary. It was Wednesday. I'm sorry. Wednesday, the specter said, we're going to close you down because your wall didn't meet the fire requirement. And I was broken. And I said, you know what? Sometimes I just tell God I'm tired. And I said, you know what? I was praying here, and then I got up. I said, we're going to worship. God did something in me. He gave me a joy. He's going to do something. And all of a sudden, we worshiped God. I worshiped God that Wednesday. And the next day, crazy. We needed 2 hours of fire rating on this wall because we have a neighbor here. And somehow, some way, the owner said, I don't know how this happened, but we have 5 layers of wall. Not two. And they opened us up. Now, God had already set that up, right? But in my human understanding, the inspector told me, you're shut down until you can fix that wall, the whole wall. And I'm like, it's Wednesday, and we have our second year anniversary on Sunday. He's like, well, let's see what God can do. God showed up. God showed up. God showed up. God showed up in a mighty way. And God shows up that way. And a lot of times people, let me talk about this in our praise and worship. And sometimes people say, well, how do I worship God in my affliction? Why am I suffering? I have an ailment that it doesn't go away. And my family's sick and my children are sick and these different things are going wrong in my life. And it becomes too much. And I like what Jesus said to his disciples when they asked why a man was born blind. If you know the story, I'm going to read some scripture here. I'm going to go through this. But I want you to pay attention to what Jesus says as he's walking. I imagine, you know, we do this when we walk and we have questions about God. Why, God, why would you allow this in someone's life? I do that. When I pray, God, I know you allowed certain things, but I want you to fix it for them. But let me read John chapter 9, a few scripture here. John chapter 9, it says in verse 1, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been blind from birth. Rabbi, his disciples asked him, why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins? It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins, Jesus answered. This happened so the power of God could be seen in him. Could be seen in him. What was their what? By his being blind, how could that give God glory? How could the power of God be shown through him? But he continues in verse 24 because Jesus heals him. But in verse 24, he says, so the second time they asked, the Pharisees were mad. Like, well, who's this guy? The Pharisees were mad. So for the second time, they called in the man who had been blind and told him, God should get the glory for this because we know this man, Jesus, is a sinner. And I don't know whether, the man said, I don't know whether he's a sinner, the man replied, but I know this. I was blind. Now I can see. I don't know who he is or what he, or if he's a sinner, but I know this. I know I was blind, but now I can see. And the man continues in verse 30, says, why, that's very strange, the man replied. He healed my eyes, and yet you don't know where he comes from? We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, but he is ready to hear those who worship him and do his will. Ever since the world began, no one has been able to open the eyes of someone born blind. If this man was not from God, he couldn't have done it. You will see things in this life, miraculous healings and all these different things. God is our healer. He's the one that makes things right. And I'm going to get ready to close, but I want you to know this. There are going to be afflictions in your life. There are many. But there's going to be times when you see God move powerfully. You don't have to understand how God did it. Thank him when he does it. Remember to give him praise and glory. And I'm going to, this story, I mean, it was so deep to me. So I think I shared it recently as well with the owner of this building. He gave us the other side to use and the cafe. We have a cafe now there. And he's a very nice man. They're a Christian couple. And I remember he gave us that building and said, the other side, he said, I will give it to you on one condition, that your congregation prays for my wife who is very sick in bed. She's very sick in bed. She has a blood condition where she's had it for, I think, about a year now. It's an infection that doctors can't figure it out. And so he goes, I'll let you use this place as long as I can before I have to rent it. Well, it came, that was in June or July, and all of a sudden, he came to me in December and said, hey, I have somebody that wants to rent the other side, and he even said, he goes, yeah, they offered me $7,000 a month to have that side, and I'm like, wow, okay, you know, great, you know, that's good, thank you for letting me use it. He says, no, hold on, I denied their offer. He says, God is doing something special there. And I'm like, amen. And he goes, let's see what God does. I'm like, okay. And then as we walked out, I saw somebody in the car. And he goes, oh, you haven't met my wife, Sally. I'm like, I was expecting to see, you know, her. I don't know what to expect. I was like, oh, be frail and fragile. And I don't know. But he said, oh, let me call her. And she was so full of joy and just excited. And she's like, oh, I haven't met you yet. She goes, hi, I'm Sally Gentry. I'm looking at her with just an amazement. Hi, good to meet you finally. And then we went to lock up. And he said, oh, because I haven't told you. He said, doctor just called us and said that her infection is gone. And he goes, I guess that's a praise report. I said, what do you mean? Praise God. And he's like, yeah, praise God. It brought tears to my eyes. When you can see God move so powerfully and take it as an everyday occurrence, I believe he's grateful. I believe she's grateful. But that's something that I have to share, because only God can do things like this. When the doctors run out of understanding, when they've given up, when they've given up, when they said, nothing we can do, she's bedridden until she goes home. He was driving around with him, smiling. He said, oh yeah. Doctor said she has no more infection. She's doing great. He said, I guess that's a praise report. He's a believer. I believe God healed her. When he said God is doing something great, God is doing something special, he gave God glory. And it's easy to live in expectation, right? When you start seeing things happen. But I want to pray with you guys. I want to pray for this church. God reveals those things to you. Because when God brings you revelation, you won't take his blessing so casual. Dude, what's a blessing in your life? I'll tell you the first one. You're here today. Some people didn't wake up this morning. Your finances might not be perfect. Your relationship might not be perfect right now. You're struggling in the inside. There's things going on in your life. If we're not careful, we'll forget the power of God can change anything. If we're not careful, there's many blessings in our life that we don't give God praise for. If we're not careful, I'm talking about all of us. If we're not careful, we'll see a miracle before our eyes and just say, you know, God is with me. If the enemy had his way, when you made a right or left turn onto Patricia, another car would have taken you out. If the enemy had his way, he hates you. He would have made sure you didn't come to be in God's presence. He would have made sure that he took the praise out of your mouth. Here's something I'll add on to that. The enemy may not win on the way here, but when you're here, did he take the praise out of your mouth? When you're here in his presence, can you still worship God? I'm not going to worship God right now because I'm going through things. Imagine if Paul and Silas, when they were in prison, they were in shackles. They were just in a dungeon. Imagine they say, God, we're doing your work and we're in prison. Yeah, I'm not going to worship or praise him. I'm mad at you right now. But instead, they decided to worship. They started to lift their hands and worship. And all of a sudden, what happens? What happens when these men decide to worship? Explosion happens. That's in the movies. Earthquake. Something profound happens. And when it happens, everybody's shackle falls off. Do you see how powerful worship is? Even when you don't feel like it, worship God. Even when the circumstance is so overwhelming, worship God. Put it on in your house. Let the music play in your house. Sing to it. Sing along. Let those worship leaders in that song lead you in worship. You don't need them. You can do it yourself. But what I'm saying this, when there's worship in your house, every demonic strategy of the enemy is cast out. The enemy wants to take you out. The enemy will come to kill, steal, and destroy. The enemy will try to set you up for the fall. But you have to remember who's with you. And I'm going to close with this story. Who knows the story of Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace? It's such a powerful story, but people say, how could that be? They get thrown into the furnace. They get thrown into the furnace. Let me share this story real quick. This is their response. when Nebuchadnezzar builds a statue and everybody, it's decreed they must bow down before this statue. If they don't bow down, they're going to be thrown in the fire. But Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego knew who their God is. And they said, so when everybody bowed, they stood standing. Let me read these couple verses. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16. And this is what their response was to King Nebuchadnezzar. I'm reading 17 actually. If that is the case, O God, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire of furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the God image which you have set up. You see, when you put God first in your life, when you do things like that, when you do things from the Lord, the enemy's going to be mad. He's going to try to set up stumbling blocks or obstacles to trip you up, to make you see him and not make him make you see the problem and not God. When you allow God to move in your life, God will see you through. You have to resist the enemy. Don't fall into his temptation. Don't fall into his traps. It's all something that the enemy wants. See, God will bring revelation to your enemy too. Just like he did King Nebi. I call him Nebi. His name is Nebuchadnezzar. King Nebi. Verse 19. It says this. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down about in the midst of the, they got thrown in the fire, midst of the fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, did we not cast three men bound in the midst of the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. Well, look, he answered, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they're not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Ooh, that's a moment right there. The enemy was mad. I'm going to take you out. I'm going to take you out. I'm going to throw so much stuff at your way. I know you're going to crumble. I know you're not going to stand for God. I'm going to mess with your finances. I'm going to give you a worldly I'm going to let you see the world, and your desire is going to want more of it. I'm going to make you see that God is not with you. I'm going to make you feel that God is not with you. I'm going to do all these things. I'm going to show you the desires of the world, worldly possession, worldly, so many things. But you as a believer, you say, you know what? I'm not going to compromise who I am for that lie of the enemy. I don't feel it right now, God. I don't see you, but I know you're with me. I know you're with me. I don't feel it right now, but I know you're with me. I know you're with me. So you have to make a decision to make. You tell the enemy, liar, devil, Satan, whatever you want to call him, you can't have me. You can't have my family. You can't have my children. You can't have my parents. You can't have my anybody that I'm praying for right now. I'm speaking life to them. You can't have it. The enemy still goes after you. He's, you don't even go to church that much. I'm gonna come after you. I'm gonna break you. Because you don't even go to church. You compromise when you're alone. You say, no, I'm not going to. Lord, I need you right now. So the enemy thinks he has his way. King Nebuchadnezzar threw these men of God into the fiery furnace. He expected them just to melt. It was so hot, the people that threw him in died. That's how hot the fire was. They threw them in, and they died right there. And he's looking in there, and he's like, what? Revelation. Didn't we throw me? He knew he threw three men in there. He asked, didn't we throw three men in there, bound? They go, oh, yeah. I'm sure the advisors were like, yeah, they were happy. Got them, we got them. Showed them. He goes, didn't we throw three? Then why is there four? And they're not hurt. He actually tells them to come out. Revelation. When you're going through something, when you're going through the fire, when you feel like you need to make a decision, your world is falling apart, finances are all messed up, relationship is struggling, job, you're trying to find a job, you don't have the right one, the family unit's not together serving God, there's all these things, it's all coming apart, you stand firm. You may not see God in the midst of it, but King Nebuchadnezzar, your enemy, will. He'll say, didn't we throw everything at them? Him and his minions, little guys. Didn't we take away everything from them? They said, we couldn't take away his praise. He's still worshiping God. He's still going to church and giving God glory. All of a sudden, they see God in you. I thought he was alone. But look at the Son of God in him. Look at the Son of God in her. Revelation. It's spiritual understanding. Where the natural falls short, supernatural kicks in. When the physical runs short, spirituality kicks in. Acts chapter 14, verse 22. Where they strengthened the believers, they encouraged them to continue in the faith, reminding them that they must suffer many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. In other words, you're going to go through things, going to suffer. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God will see you through each one. God will see you through each one. And I'm going to share this story before we pray. I think I've shared it before. I can't remember if I have or not, but I want you just to remove every distraction. I just receive right now. The story of the emperor moth. I think I read it before. But it's such a profound story. It says the emperor's moth struggled to get out of the cocoon. It's trying to break out of the cocoon. A man saw it struggling and decided to help with the cocoon. When it was free, its body was swollen and wings were shriveled. The body was swollen, the wings were shriveled wings. The man helped it, but didn't help the moth. He helped it out of the cocoon, but he didn't help the moth. The moth's struggle to get out of the cocoon actually helps the blood flow in the body to the wings to strengthen the wings. However, because of the mercy shown, the wings stayed shriveled and weak and could not change. If the moth would have been allowed to struggle, it would have turned into a beautiful butterfly. You ask God, why am I struggling right now? God, why am I struggling? Why am I going through this? God, why haven't you responded yet? See, God knows. If the help that you want comes now, what will you have? How will you be strengthened? We have to believe that God's plan is the best plan. We have to believe God's way is the best way. We have to believe God's timing is the best timing. So through your struggle, expect your blessing. Through your struggle, expect your praise report. Through your struggle, expect that God's going to move and you're going to see the miracle that you want. Revelation. Revelation. You know what happens when we go through problems and all of a sudden we don't see God in it? We start saying, I need to figure this out myself. God, you're not going to move. I'm going to do it myself. But like Jesus said before he went to the cross, remove this from me, God. Remove this cup of pain, of suffering. Remove it. I know what it's coming. I'm tired. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Before he went to the cross, that was his prayer. Before he went to the cross, and he prayed and prayed. Imagine the suffering that Jesus went through all for us. Imagine the suffering, all the pain he went through, he endured. He went to the cross willingly because it was God's will. And then when he dies, gives everything for you and I, and when the people reject him, still. Imagine the price he had to pay and people don't care. That's understandable when the revelation hasn't come. But for us, where revelation has come and we follow him, imagine what he went through for you and I. And he says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but I'm going to see you through every one of them. I'm going to see you through every one of them. See, today you might be wondering, why am I going through this still? You might be wondering when God's going to move in your life. You might be wondering, when's the joy of the Lord going to come and be my strength? You might be wondering all these things. You might be wondering, when's revelation going to come to me? If you're a believer in this house, expect your revelation comes when you ask. Expect your revelation. You see, that's the thing with revelation. God reveals things to you. But if he revealed the whole story, you probably wouldn't want the blessing. God, when am I going to be blessed? He goes, well, you're going to go through this and this and this and this and this. Oh, forget it. I don't want that blessing. That's what happens. God knows. But he doesn't want to share the whole story. He lights up the stone right in front of you. He lights up your path so you can navigate with him. The Bible says, trust the Lord. Trust the Lord with everything, with all your heart and mind. But what does it say after? But don't rely on what? Your understanding. God will show you the way. But today I want to pray. I want to pray what Paul prayed, that you understand the power. You understand the power and the love of God that resides in you. The power to overcome anything. The power to resist the enemy. The power to walk in faith. The power to walk in authority and boldness. The power to give God glory. The power to let the praise come out of you. The power to worship God no matter what. It's not easy, humanly speaking. I know. But when you allow the Holy Spirit to come upon you, when Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, that was in his struggle. I want everybody in here today, my prayer is that you receive the understanding, the spiritual enlightenment of who God created you and how powerful you are as a believer. And if you're not a believer, I want to invite you. Because only God can do that. Only God brings change and understanding for you. I can't do that. I'm just here being obedient to his word and doing what he's called me to do. But I know God has a plan for every person. How do I know that? Because he created you. He created you on purpose, with purpose, for him and his glory. He could do a mighty work through you. For those that believe and receive, God's waiting for you. I'm going to do one more thing, and we're going to worship God. And as I pray today, if you feel like, you know what, I want that revelation. I want that understanding. As we worship, I'm going to invite you to come to the front. I'm going to invite you to come to the front as you begin to worship Mackenzie. And we're going to close this service, but I want to invite you to the front as we conclude this service. So would you stand to your feet with me and just ask God to bring revelation. But if you want to come to the front, the altar's open. And I'm going to pray and believe God that he brings revelation and understanding to you. I want to pray that God changes those things in your mind that, you know what? I've seen God move, but I don't feel him now. I've seen God move. Lord, I want to understand why. I want to understand why these things happen. Lord, I want to understand the plan for my life. Lord, I want to understand. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I want to know what you have for me and my family. I want to know what you have for me and my marriage. I want to know what you have for me and my kids. I want to know, Lord. Oh, Lord, by your Spirit, where revelation comes. You see, you may feel like you're not worthy to receive those things because of the mistakes that you've made. Or the past has been too hard, and there may be some stuff in the past that hinders you from giving it all to the Lord. Or you may say, I don't want people to know that I'm suffering, so I'm not going to say anything or I'm not going to do anything. The Lord knows. And like my brother said earlier, yes, our past have formed us today. We're products of our past, but we're not prisoners of our past. Don't live there. Don't live there in pain. Don't live there in betrayal. Don't live there in denial. Don't live there because somebody told you you couldn't do anything else. Somebody told you you weren't worth it. Somebody told you you would never make anything of yourself. Somebody told you you're a disgrace. Somebody told you I disown you. Somebody told you I don't love you. Somebody told you you'll never do anything in your life. It hurts the most when people are closest to us and they tell you they don't love you. It hurts the most when people in your life tell you they don't need you. It hurts the most when people tell you, I wish you weren't in my life. Go away. But all those things are lies from the enemy. When God says, I want you. I love you. I'm here for you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. All those things that, humanly speaking, I just want to be loved. I just want peace in my life. I just want the joy of the Lord that the Word speaks of. I want that to be my strength. All those come when you ask. So if you're sitting in your seat still, or if you're standing, if you want to come to the front, worship with me. Worship with me. You can worship again.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee. Oh.
stood in the power of the presence, for I felt the depths of your mercy. Oh, how your love, it always surrounds me. For I taste and see your goodness, and I stood in the power of your presence. For I felt the depths of your mercy.
Praise and all the love. Guidance and your blessing and favor upon each and every person in this place, Lord Jesus. Thank you so much, Lord. We love you so much, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys for coming to Reclaim San Antonio. Just a reminder that men's discipleship is this Monday at Reclaim Hutto. We'll be meeting at Pastor's house at 4 p.m. So if you have any questions, please let our pastors know. This concludes our Sunday service. Have a safe trip home. God bless you.